Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Go ahead, take a seat. Tonight, it's an interesting thought. I'd like to share it with you. The fight for life. Let's talk for a moment. This title of this message could mean a lot of things. The fight for your life is without a doubt going to happen as you fight. When you become a Christian, one of the things that we think is that we're going to live a life of peace, and that is going to happen in your existence in heaven. But while you're here on earth, I might remind you that you're in a battle. In fact, the proof of that is within the first three chapters of Genesis. Right off from the very beginning, introduced to you was your enemy. Hate your guts because you're made in the image of God. You haven't done anything, but you were born a human. And with that, you have a lot of potential. Not only that, that if you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've been blood washed and you're in the family of God and your DNA is changed and you have the ability to change your background and change the future. You are a threat to everything around you. But without one little word, you become impotent as you approach the future, and the word is fight. So many of us take for granted that there's not a fight when there is a fight. So many of us understand, well, that's all I'll do is be a good Christian. I'll go to church. I'll bring my tithe. I'll be a person that, you know, I'll stop doing those things that I used to do. And that's all fine and great, and you should do those things. But there's also something we need to do as Christians is we need to be fighters. Everything that you're seeing in this place, someone fought for. It did not just happen. To this very day, we're still fighting as a church, trying to make ends meet. You would think after ministering all of those times on the blessed life and all of those series that everything would be fine. Everything would be great. Economics would flood into this place. Man, I'm telling you, that did not happen here at the Rock Church. Some of you upped things and some of you gave extra, and thank God for you. But most people didn't hear it at all, and it was a fight. It's still a fight to make things work and to keep on going. It was a fight to start it. It's a fight to keep it going, and it's a fight to see results. And that's no different in this church as it is in your personal life. In order for you to have the life that God wants you to have, a blessed life, you're going to have to understand that there's a fight ahead of you. And a fight every day. Most people, I remember one time in the past as I was ministering on this subject, a lady in our church came up and said, I just don't want to fight. I don't blame her. I don't want to fight either. She said, I just want to live with my husband and my wife and my kids and my family together. And I just don't want to fight. She says, I'm a Christian. I know I'm going to heaven, and I thank God for that. There's no doubt about that inside me, but this fighting stuff is just ridiculous. And I have to tell you from the bottom of my heart, it broke my heart because I saw somebody who wanted to be a Christian, didn't realize in order for her to take ground, you're going to have to fight for it. Because if it just came because you're a Christian, then why don't we all have it? If it just came because we're Christians, then why aren't we all blessed? If it just came because you're a Christian, why isn't the doors open for you and the ones that need to be closed, closed for you? Why does it? Because there's certain things you and I are going to have to understand. There's a fight for our life. I got a text a few months back from a friend of mine who's a pastor, and he said these words. He said, it was about a Monday or Tuesday. He says, I've got to see the dentist on Thursday. You better pray for me. He said, I've got to do 3 months worth of flossing in 2 days. How many of you realize you can't do 3 months of flossing in 2 days? Oftentimes, that's what we do is we wait until the last moment when the pressure's on for us to fight. When we should have been fighting all along. I'm going to make a statement to you. I heard it said by a minister one time, and it's so true. New levels bring new devils. Some of you have heard that before. And if you're going to fight the new devils with the old levels, you're going to fail. And you're going to have to step up your battle all the time and become more dependent on the King of Glory. And you're going to have to be somebody who realizes this is an important thing ahead of me. My family is worth the battle. My marriage is worth the battle. That husband that I'm believing for is worth the battle. That wife that I'm believing for is worth the battle. That business that's prosperous is worth the battle. And let me tell you something, the saints of God, it's not a bad thing to be in battle. In fact, you'll see it all through the Old Testament. There's one illustration after another, isn't there? From everything you can think of, from Jerusalem to Israel to the battles they had with the Israelites to the Philistines and all the kings, everybody's battling, everybody's in, and you read this, it's really the Old Testament is a bloody example of a spiritual truth for us in the New Testament. And so we don't think that way. We want to make people comfortable when they come to church. We want to make them happy, filled, laughter. You know, let's sing a song, give them goosebumps, and walk out of the place. And we wonder why they're never successful, because there's a battle. I mean, if you have illness in your body, it's worth a battle to get that out of your body. And so I'm telling you tonight, you can't fight tomorrow's problems with yesterday's tactics. You're going to have to step up in your battle. I have to be honest with you. I prayed for my children, but I never prayed for my children like my wife prayed for my children. My children, as you know the story, all of them are amazing. They're all serving God. It's phenomenal. Our oldest child has a church of 3,000 people in Temecula, and it's just amazing the things that are going on. All the rest of them are in ministry. If we could have drawn out a picture of their future, we would have drawn this picture for you. We didn't do any of that. All we did was go to war. And I remember hearing my wife war at night, half the night long. I mean, I'd be in the other room thinking I wasn't even saved. She's in there praying. She'd ask me oftentimes, you want to get up? It's 2 o'clock in the morning. I said, no. I was very bad. But she's, and there's no doubt about it, in our older age, we've sat back and we've gotten comfortable because we're just like you. We want to be comfortable. We don't want to fight the fight. We don't want to get up in the middle of the night and battle, even though what we're battling for is really important. It could be your health. It could be your finances. It could be your house. It could be your home business. It could be your children. It could be their future. It could be your grandchildren. It could be whatever it is. There's a battle out there. Oftentimes, we don't take the fight at hand. We wait until the last minute, and then we start flossing. And it just doesn't work. So tonight I want to share some things with you to kind of stimulate you to get back into the battle. Let's talk about it just for a little bit. Because if you're going to approach a blessing in a future, you're going to fight for it. And if you want to be blessed by God, you better be ready to fight for it. I'm telling you, nothing just happens because you're there. Nothing happens because you're in the right place at the right time with God. It doesn't work that way. God blesses those who are on his side. I love what Dr. Gilfillan said last week. A dad was teaching his son some truths about the Bible. He got him in a rowboat, put on one row, he put works on the other oar, he put works on the other oar, he put the word prayer. Or faith, I think you said it was. Faith and works. And he said to his son, he said, okay, he says, take this oar and start rowing. This is works. And he started rowing and it went around in a circle. And he said, well, that doesn't work very good. Take faith and row with that and to see how that goes. And he rowed with the oar of faith and it didn't do anything but go around in a circle. He said, now take both of them, row together, if you remember the message. And now you're headed in a straight line. And all of us are called by God to go forward, but it's going to take a battle. Your faith, listen to this, and your works. You're going to have to fight this good fight of faith. There's some things I wanted to share with you tonight. It's important for us to see. There are five little areas that I'd like to look at, and we'll go to the courtyard and play a little bit. And I think it's important for us to take a look at this. The battle, here's number one. The battle is always the same. I don't care what level you're at. I don't care where you're at. The battle is always the same. And it always takes place in the same place. The battleground is always the same. You know, sometimes you change battlegrounds and you have different tactics, but it's so interesting for us, the battleground is always the same. We need to learn something. If you'll go with me to the writings of Paul in the book of Romans in the 7th chapter, I want to read something to you in the 7th chapter of Romans. Here's Paul. Now you would think for a moment, wouldn't you, that Paul has got it all together. I mean, if anybody's going to get blessed, it's going to be Paul. Because here's Paul, and he has written 2/3 of the New Testament. He's got a revelation of grace. I mean, he is an amazing man of God. And yet, all through his life, as an example for you and an example for me, who's going to accomplish something, he's in a battle all the time. In fact, in 2 Corinthians, he describes it that the enemy buffets him all the time, like the waves of the ocean. The word described there, buffeting, means like waves coming in one after another. They just don't stop. They just keep going. And you know, sometimes those waves will get smaller, and that's when we start to coast. And when we coast, now we're flossing 2 days before we see the dentist. And it just doesn't work. And Paul writes something about the battle that he's in that is always the same common ground for every one of us. If I know it's the same, and it's the same place, then I have an advantage on how to deal with the battles that I'm going to be facing in order to get to where I need to go. In the 7th chapter, starting in verse number 23, he says, "But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity, into the law of sin, and which is in my members." So let's take a look at it just for a second. He says, "I see something else taking place on the inside of me." This is Paul. He says, "The law of my members, another law of my members." In other words, there's an action on the inside. My physical body is at war with the spiritual things. The Bible tells us in Galatians, the 5th chapter, that the spirit and the flesh cannot work together. They're at enmity. They're at odds against each other. If you try to be spiritual and also try to be fleshly, which, by the way, most Christians do, try to do at least, you can't make it. And he says, there's another law in my members, in my physical bodies. Watch this. Warring against the law of my mind. My mind tells me one thing, but my flesh tells me something else. I mean, there's a war going on that's taking place here. Yeah. And it's taking place in your heart, in your mind, in your soul, in your thinking. That's why the attack is always the same. It's the attack of the inside. Did you know something? That probably every physical thing that we're going through right now started with an inside attack, and we allowed it to come and take place inside of us. Even if it's a physical problem that you have, or a financial problem, a physical characteristic, some kind of something going on in your life, it probably started with something that attacked something on the inside and was allowed to continue without warring against it. That's why we see so many people. Next time I share with you, I'm going to share something about how to change your DNA. A lot of people don't think you can change your DNA. I mean, according to the scripture, and I'll show you this, that when you came into relationship with God, you have now the ability to eliminate those characteristics from the past and take on the characteristics of your new family in the future. And this is warring in his members, bringing him into captivity to the law, which is sin, which is in his members, in his physical body. Verse number 24 says it like this. As we read verse number 24, it says this: "Oh, wicked man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of death?" I mean, this is a war going on in the apostle's life. Are you kidding me? He's beaten. He's been in jail. He's been whipped. He's been sunk in the seas for 3 days, 3 nights. He's been snake bit. I mean, how would you like to have a mandate from God that says, I want you to write in such a way that they'll change the world, that everybody will know about the grace of God, the love of God, what to do with the grace of God. But I'm going to take you, have you whipped, beat, put in chains, throw you in prison. I mean, every one of us would say, you got to be kidding me. And so what happens, even in the midst of his warring, he wins. Look at us tonight, listening to what he has to say. Thousands of years later, a war goes on. He says, oh, wicked man, who have delivered me from the body? You have to understand something. You might be in a war, but there's a deliverance waiting for you. And see, can I say something? He didn't say, I hope I get delivered. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. He's going to win the battle. He goes to God. He says, God, I'm buffeted constantly. These waves of sin, this enemy that's coming against me is buffeting me on a constant basis. God looks at him and says, my grace is sufficient for you. And then he comes along and makes a statement, and he says this. He says, in my weakness, in my battle time, in when I'm knocked down, I'm made strong, because in my weakness, God's made strong. I'm telling you guys, we win the battle. You got to understand that. Verse number 25 comes along. Oh, wicked man, who will I say that I am? Oh, thank God. And he doesn't say, I hope Jesus comes through. Through Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So with my mind, I will serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. I can't let my flesh rule my mind. My soul has got to rule my flesh. Come on, somebody. And that's where the battleground is always the same. The second thing I wanted to point out about a good fight, and it's important for us to see, is the battle is spiritual. I don't care if you're in a physical battle right now. The battle is spiritual. I don't care if you're physically sick, financially broke, depressed, discouraged. I don't care if you have anxiety that keeps you awake all night long. I don't care if you have some physical problem. You may have them, but it all started on a spiritual plane. And a lot of people don't understand that. I'm looking here at the front row as Ron. Ron, wave at everybody. Ron told me today, how old are you, Ron?
I'll be 68.
68. He just raced his son, who is one of the fastest football players. His son's, what, 48 or something like that? 46? Just raced him in a race, a foot race for 50 yards. Oh, my goodness. That's not a race between a 46-year-old and a 68-year-old. You got to be kidding me. And wait a minute. The 68-year-old that's sitting on the front row was diagnosed a few months ago with terminal cancer and is supposed to die. And can I tell you something, Ron? You are going to die. And there's a season for you to die, and God's going to tell us what the season is, but the devil's not going to tell you. And I don't care what anybody says. Can I tell you something? Ron realized, listen to me, hold on. Ron realized this is a spiritual battle. And he had to do some kind of fighting in order to win. He's now been diagnosed as being cancer-free. He has gone totally free of that. And he's 68 years old. Racing his 46-year-old son, and his son beat him by one step. I don't mind racing my grandchildren 7 inches, but I'm not going to race 50 yards. Was it 50 yards? 50 yards. Oh, my goodness sakes alive, my friend. Good for you. There's a man that's supposed to be dead today. No hope whatsoever. He realized that it was a physical problem, but it was a spiritual problem. And you know what he did? He dove in head first, and he went for God until people thought he was crazy. But can I tell you something? I don't give a flip what people think. People aren't going to heal me. People aren't going to take care of my finances. People aren't going to build my business. People aren't going to give me favor. Why do we listen to people? Because it's a spiritual battle all the time. In the same battleground, when he realized he had a spiritual problem and not a physical problem, he got all into God, got crazy to everybody around him, including his doctor, and all of a sudden he's getting reports that nobody ought to be getting at his age. But come on, somebody. This is a spiritual battle. Let me show it to you in the scripture, if I may describe. First of all, you will never see any kind of a battle in the New Testament that isn't spiritual. Isn't that fascinating? This is a spiritual battle, and we need to see this. And it's so important for us to see this. In 2 Corinthians 10, chapter verse number 4, says this, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God to the pulling down of strongholds. It didn't say the weapons of our warfare are carnal. That means physical. That means, you know, I've told you this before and taught you this. See, the word carnal up there is a word that we get the word meat. Carnal means meat, flesh, flesh. Like when you eat chili con carne, that means beans with chili and meat. When you're a meathead, that means you're carnal thinking. And so he says the weapon of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God to the pulling. It's a spiritual battle. Is anybody listening to me? The only thing you do with a spiritual battle is you wait until you have a major problem and then you start flossing, right? No, you start dealing with the problems that are coming tomorrow, which you don't even know what they are. You start dealing with them today. Because if you wait until tomorrow, it's too late. Are you listening? And somebody who wants to win the battles before they ever come starts dealing with them now. That means you set time aside and you go after the enemy. Now let's talk about the enemy, which brings us to number three, which is so important for us to see. Because without this understanding, we're gonna see something take place. Number three is that the battle is with an enemy, by the way, that is invisible. You have a battle with an invisible enemy. That's why faith is so important. If you look at things through your flesh, what you feel, taste, smell, or touch, then you're dealing with the problem that's spiritual on the level of your flesh, and it won't work. But if you realize that this is a spiritual thing, that is such a spiritual thing that you have an enemy that is invisible. What am I saying? That's why faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things, what is the word? Not seen. And so in other words, I'm gonna have faith about something that is not seen. I don't see the enemy. I do see the physical response in my body. I do see the lack of finances in my life. I do see doors not being open. I do see all the natural, but guess what? My enemy is not in the natural. My enemy is very, if you will, interesting. He is a principality or a power. And listen to what it says, if you will, in Ephesians, the 6th chapter. Go there with me in Ephesians, the 6th chapter. Ephesians, the 6th chapter. Verse number 12 says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. I mean, guys, listen to me. I mean, you think I'm as crazy as you want to think, but for 40 years, I've been listening to this, studying this, and understanding this. And that's why I'm standing before you tonight, telling you something. If you learn this and understand this, this is going to bless your future. My enemy is not the neighbor next door who has a barking dog. My enemy is not the boss that I go to work with. My enemy is not somebody who criticizes or judges me. My enemy is not my wife, or if you're a wife, you're not your husband. Your enemy, listen to this, we wrestle not with flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers and darkness of this age. They know what's going on today at this time. They know how to deal with your mind, get you back into a physical battle, when in fact it's a spiritual battle. So these are unseen principalities and powers, listen to this, against spiritual hosts and wickedness in heavenly places. At no time does he say that he's gonna manifest in the physical, but yet we try to fight and we fight every fight on the physical instead of realizing our fight is spiritual with an enemy we cannot see. The fourth thing that I wanna share with you tonight, which is important, is this, is the battle. And it's so important for us to see, is a battle of faith. And I said it like this on the overhead, the battle is a faith fight. It's a faith fight, meaning this is the only way to please God. You're gonna have to believe God. You're gonna have to stand and resist the devil, and he, Bible says, he will flee. But if you don't stand and resist on a fiery basis, the same thing that he's pouring out to you, guess what? He won't flee. He'll think you're wimpy. But if he knows you're going to stand, what kind of a characteristic is your is the devil coming against you? The Bible tells us he was cast out of heaven because he was what? He had a pride. When he realizes he's going to lose, he backs off. With Ron, it was the same exact thing. As soon as Ron lets up, he's coming back. He's full of pride. As soon as he realizes you're not backing off, you're not backing down, you're not giving up, you're not quitting, then it comes along. It's a faith fight. As soon as he realizes that you know who he is and what rights you have being born of the Spirit of God and having the DNA of God Almighty, that you're a king's kid, that God opens doors no man can open and closes doors no man can close, when you realize who you are, the devil's got to back down. Because it says resist him and he will do something. He will flee, my friends. We're in a faith fight. And that's what this is really all about. Let's take a look at it in the scripture, if you will, in the word of the Lord in 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. Go there with me in 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. In 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter, let's take a look at verse number 12. I love this as Paul writes to Timothy, and he makes a statement to Timothy that all of us need to adhere to. He says these words, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold of eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Fight the good fight of fight the good fight of
faith.
Fight the good fight of
faith.
Listen, it's not on the overhead, but in 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter, verse number 7. You're right there in 1 Timothy. Go to 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter, verse number 7. Listen to what he says. At the end of Paul's life, he makes this statement. He says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the
faith.
Come on, yell it out at me. I've kept the what?
Faith.
And see, everything that's going to be accomplished, everything's ever going to be done, is not being done because you're sweet and pretty and smart, not being done because you have degrees or have money or have a good background, not being done because you have perfect English pronunciation. It's going to be done because you have faith in the mighty God. He's looking for somebody on this planet who will believe that he is greater than all the physical problems on this earth. My goodness sakes alive, are you telling me the problems you have are greater than his ability to take care of them? The God who speaks and the planets that come into line, the God that holds it all together, you gotta be kidding me. You don't have a problem big enough that he can't solve. And you say, why doesn't he fight? Because we're not fighting the fight that we need to fight. It's a fight of faith. Whew. Is anybody listening? It's important for us to see this. Number 5 is the battle demands your all. This is where people fail. So many times people say, well, how'd you get this big facility? I mean, guys, we were broke. Nobody came along with a magic wand. Nobody gave us anything. We were broke. We were a little church pastoring in San Bernardino in a little building. God said, I want you to build a building, and I'm here to tell you something, that this great building that looks better today than it did 12 years ago, cleaner today than it was 12 years ago, was built that's worth $45 million because God built it. And we only owe, what, $5 or $6 million or $7 million on it at this point, but can I just say this to you? That's not because of anything but what God's done. When we built it, we didn't have any money. I didn't know how we were going to make it. I thought I was going to be the biggest laughing stock in the world. But it took something. It took everything we had day in and day out. It wasn't a token prayer when I got up in the morning. It wasn't a little acknowledgement at night. It was God all day long. I was flossing all day long. You know what I'm saying? And so was Deborah. All of a sudden, they're ready to put the seats in. The guy said, "We're ready to deliver all the seats." And this is 12 years ago. And we said, every one of those seats that you see have a thread running through them. The colors of the carpet and platform, the walls, everything are found inside the seats in front of you. We'd been sitting on metal chairs long enough. We found out that God wanted to bless us. It was going to be a fight. They called us on the phone. I'll never forget this. They said, "We're ready, Pastor, to deliver all the chairs next week, but we've got to have a check." I said, "Okay, how much you need?" They said, $400,000. We didn't have nothing. Can I tell you something? Somehow, these chairs got delivered and paid for. I don't even remember how. It just happened. God just opened the door and it just happened. What am I saying? It doesn't happen unless somebody's going to put all into it. The future is for somebody who's going to put all into it. Not just do it, but get in and do it morning, noon, and night. Fight that fight for those kids. Fight that fight for that business. Fight that spiritual battle for your marriage. Fight that spiritual battle for your children. Fight that spiritual battle for your future. Fight that spiritual battle for your finances. Listen, floss before you see the dentist. And what we do is we don't do that. We wait until the battle has started and it's in full array before we start to put on the armor. And the Bible says these words, and I think they're great ones, in 2 Timothy. I'm going to finish with this tonight. If you'll go to the second chapter of 2 Timothy, he makes a statement to Timothy, and he says, verse number 4, "No one engages in warfare, entangles himself with the affairs of this life." It means you can't walk on both sides of the fence. You're going to have to be like Ron is in these last 6 months of his life. You're going to have to get pretty radical. You're going to have to fight this fight. Has nothing to do with how smart you are, clever you are, talented or gifted you are. Has everything to do with your heart and your commitment to God and how much you're ready, willing, and able to pay for it. You see the word entangled up there? It's an interesting word. No one engaged in warfare, isn't that interesting? Entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him. By the way, the Bible says in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 6, the only way to please God is but by how? Faith. So when he makes this statement that he may please him, he's talking about living that life of faith more than the problems. When my faith is bigger than the problems got to go. He says, may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Say it again, as a what?
Soldier.
I didn't hear you, as a what?
Soldier.
Man, listen to what he's saying, who you are. Can I just say something? The person who made that statement to me about how they did not want to fight was stricken with a disease, and life was ruined, never to ever be normal again. This is a fight, my friends. Broke my heart, but I always remember those words. I don't want to fight, okay? If you don't want to, then don't. But what's coming, you didn't have to have it. You better be ready to deal with it. It's your call. And he makes this statement. No one is engaged in a warfare, entangles himself. I'd like to just take you real quick, hold your spot there, and go with me, if you will, to Isaiah, the 40th chapter, verse 31. And it says these words, which are fascinating. "But those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." You see that? This is the interesting part about this. Those who wait. Sometimes people translate that. I heard it just recently by a great minister, translated to those that sit back and wait on God. That's just such junk. The root of the original text, of the Hebrew original text, is this: to entangle yourself by winding around yourself. It really is described as this, as one who waits to bind together like a cord. You can either bind together like a cord, and that cord gets strong, like a three-pronged cord is stronger than a single cord. By binding it all together, wrapping it, entwining itself all together. Or you can entangle yourself in the affairs of this world and lose the physical battle along with the spiritual battle. And it's time for us to realize it really does describe something. It says, if you will take your life and twist it together with God so that the two of you become like one in a spiritual battle, you'll not only be strong, but you go back to verse 31, if you will. You'll not only be strong, but you'll run and not be weary. Listen to this. You shall walk and not faint. You'll mount up with wings like eagles. All because you're now no longer entangled in the world, waiting for worldly results to give you the freedom that you're desiring, but you're entangled with God in such a way that He makes things done and wins those battles for you. Every single person that has ever won a battle in the New Testament and Old Testament, especially the Old Testament, is somebody who put God out in front. And for our lives, every day, every moment, God's got to be out in front. You got pain in your body, you don't know how to do it, you tell your pain to go to hell. You're not going there with it. They're healed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You got anxiety, you tell your anxiety to go to hell. You're not going to hell with your anxiety. You got a problem, guess what? Tell it to go to hell. You get up and you fight a good fight of faith. And you believe God. And you don't let the physical rule your spiritual. You let your spiritual rule your physical. Anything you're talking about, you're talking about growing a church, you're talking about making a church, you're talking about growing a business, you're talking about raising your children, you're having a great marriage, you're talking about being blessed, financially acceptable, you're talking about being healthy all the days of your life. I'm here to tell you something. It's going to take a fight on your behalf. If not, you're going to floss right before you go to the dentist and get nowhere because you're not going to trick him one bit. And it's your call. Nobody can do this for you. There's no pastor in the world. You can come up in a service, he lays hands on you, you fall down, somebody catches you from behind, everybody goes, da, 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 and everybody thinks it's real spiritual, walk out, you got the same problem. You know why? Because you're not fighting the right kind of faith. Amen. There's a fight to fight. And when you stop fighting, you lose. But if you keep fighting and step it up with every level you go, you're going to go somewhere new. It's a new battle. You're going to have to get up and get going. Tell the devil who you are. Tell the devil where he's going and listen to nothing else but what God says, not what your friends say, the naysayers say, what people say, your mama said, your daddy said, the sergeant in the army says, your boss says. Don't give a flip what your school teachers told you. Don't give a flip about anything else except what God says. God says that's the way it is. Spiritually, I won the battle. Or you just keep going to church and let somebody sprinkle water and blow smoke and incense on you. And hope that works. Trust me, it doesn't work. I was there for years as a drunk. It's time now to make some changes. It's time now not to sit back. Time now is to go to war even before the war has started. Here's why. Because I promise you, the war is going to start. I promise you. As an old man, I'm telling you, and it's in that war that most people that used to attend church no longer attend church because they lost, because they didn't understand. Their position was to fight a good fight of faith. Come on, somebody, give the Lord a great big praise. I'm finished. I just want to make sure everybody's all right with God before you go. Some of you need to understand and know that until you give God all of your heart and all of your life, you're not saved. It's as simple as that. Nowhere in the Bible, let me point it out to you, nowhere in the Bible does it say you go to church, become a Christian, be saved, because you go to church. Nowhere in the Bible does it say because you know who Jesus is, you get to go to heaven. Even the devil knows who Jesus is. He's not going to heaven. So head knowledge doesn't get you there. America's filled with people who call themselves Christians, and they're unfortunately not real Christians at all. I'm not the judge, but I know that because you can't just call yourself a Christian and be a Christian. Listen, the Bible makes it very clear in the scripture that your parents can't tell you you're a Christian, and that makes you a Christian. Jesus said it like this to a very reputable man, better than all of us. His name was Nicodemus. What a funny name that is, Nicodemus, John 3rd chapter. He makes a statement that you must be born again. What a revolution was starting to take place to Nicodemus. Nicodemus doesn't even understand what he's talking about, but this guy Nicodemus was better probably than all of us, I said. I mean, he was a keeper of the law, memorized the scripture, quoted the scripture, watch this, debated the scripture, watch this. How many of you have done this? Sang the scripture, was the head of his church, the synagogue, probably fed the poor, did all the great things. I would have thought for sure, wouldn't you, that Jesus would have patted him on the back and said, good job, Nicodemus. Wow, you're going to love heaven. Heaven's waiting for you, but he doesn't. He comes to Nicodemus and he says, Nicodemus, you must be born again. Now, most people attend American churches, and this is a sad statement, but it's a true statement, so listen. Most people that attend American churches don't know what born again really means. All they know about born again people is they're idiots, fanaticals, radicals, and crazy, because Hollywood's made born again people look like stupid idiots. But that's not what God's talking about. Born again means this, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it means you have given God all of your heart, all of your life. Did you know that's what God's after? All of your heart and all of your life. No, listen to me. Let me say it again. All of your heart, all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. I might as well prove it to you. All or nothing, okay? All or nothing. I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, you've heard of the book Revelation. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Oh my goodness. Who's he speaking to? He's speaking to people who call themselves Christians. And he says, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. In other words, you will not make it if you're lukewarm. Whew. What's lukewarm? Let me define it for you. Little in, little out. Little up, little down, token prayer, occasional church attendance. Lukewarm is somebody who's really not against God. Watch this, not against God, but not wholehearted for God. How many times do you know people that are that way? They're not against God, but they're not wholehearted for God. Their commitment level to God is, well, whatever. Some of you that are in here tonight need to make a change. You need to give God all of your heart. You need to give God all of your life. Be born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. You don't want to go to hell, and you know it. And someone needs to tell you, if you don't get right with God by giving God all of your heart and giving God all of your life, you're going to die and go to hell. And that's the way it is. And somebody needs to tell you the truth. Somebody who loves you enough, respects you enough, and honors you enough to tell you the truth. I love you, respect you enough, and honor you enough not to play games with you, but tell you the truth. You're going to die and go to hell if you don't get right with God and give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. You say, well, I don't want to do that. I know you don't. That's your flesh talking, but follow the Spirit. You're in a battle right now, and it's a spiritual battle. So all of a sudden, all this thinking's going on in your head. How do I do this? Well, let me tell you how to do it. Let's do it God's way, not your way, not my way, or some well-meaning church committee's way, but let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. Wow, come on. Listen to these words. If you confess me before men, I'm a man. I'll see you in a moment. Raise your hand because I'm going to count. I'm going to go like this. One, two, three, and I'll pound my Bible. Go bang. When you hear that sound, bang, your hand goes up. When I see your hand go up, what you're saying by the raising of your hand, you're saying, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. I want to give God all of my heart, give God all of my life. Someone came up to me at the back door a few years ago, and they said, listen, if God wants my heart, he'll just take it. Are you kidding me? God's not a trespasser. He's not a thief. He's not a conniver. He's not a manipulator. He's not coming and make you do this, hit you in the head with a 2x4. It's got to be a free will call. That's why this is all about choice. What do you choose? That's why I'm not bothered by what the Congress says or the Supreme Court. If we were in the days of Jesus, we're not bothered by the Romans. You don't see anything that says anything about fighting the Romans. Here's why. Because guess what? It's all about choice. No matter how bad the world gets, no matter how bad the Supreme Court makes choices, can I tell you something that makes judgment? You still come up with a choice. That's what this is all about. Nobody can take that choice from you. And tonight, I'm giving you an opportunity to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. Here we are in a safe, friendly place. We've laughed, we've clapped, we've sung songs. Wow, we've heard great testimonies. You listen to the Word of God. It was a wonderful time. It's your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three, go like this, bang, at three, you get your hand up, I'll see it. Who should raise your hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, never given him all of your life, hey, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are not sure, make sure, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people who say, well, I prayed with Billy Graham one time, or I prayed on a Harvest Crusade one time, or I prayed at my old church one time, but did you follow through the prayer with all of your heart? Now, wait a minute, listen to me. Did you follow through with a prayer with all of your heart? Or did you just say a prayer like some like token, abracadabra, magical words that God is so stupid in heaven, he says, oh, I heard them say the right formula for words. They get to come to heaven. No way. He doesn't hear your words. He watches your heart to see if your words are real. Come on, this is all about the heart. I'm going to count to three. If you've never given him all of your heart, if you need to make a new commitment to God, tonight is your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three. Bang! You get your hand up. Let me see it. Put it right back down. That simple. You say, Pastor, I'll be embarrassed. Uh-huh, you might be. Yep, you might be embarrassed. Get over it. Better to be embarrassed in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever, ever and ever. Man, come on. You know better than that. Who cares what people think? Tonight, you need God to see you. Giving him all of your heart and all of your life. Make that choice. All across this auditorium, I'm counting to three. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two, three, four. Thank you. Five, six, seven, eight. Thank you. Nine back here. There's 10. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Real quick, there's 10 wise people. Anybody on this side? Anybody on this side? Anybody on this side? Back here. Oh, I got you. I think I got you, but I'll count you again. 11. Thank you. God bless you. All the sinners sat on this side tonight. Nobody on that side has ever said, they're all right. You know what I mean? Anybody on this side? You know you need to get up? Come on, put your head up. Didn't embarrass them, I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Come on, give the Lord a great big praise for 11 people. Okay, now here's what I want you to do. All 11 people that raised their hand, anybody that should have raised their hand but didn't raise their hand, why don't you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend, get your stuff. Is that okay? Get in the aisle, meet me right in front. And let's stand and welcome them as they come. All 11 of you that raised your hand, you're serious about God, anybody that should have, you come right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
Jesus, I believe.
Come on, come on, come on. Bring a friend if you need to.
Jesus, I belong.
Come on, if you raise your hand, serious, come on.
You're the reason that I breathe. Jesus, I believe.
Just get your stuff and come. Come on.
Jesus, I belong to you. You're the reason that I live.
Well, thank God you guys have come. We're just excited about all of you. I want you to look to your left. This is one of the coolest guys on the whole planet. His name is Pastor Joel. And so Pastor Joel's going to do three things. Let me tell you what they are so you won't be afraid, okay? One, he's going to take you over to that side of the sanctuary. I've just beat the snot out of you. No, I'm just playing with you a little bit. He's going to pray with you, lead you in a prayer, because you got to invite Jesus into your heart, and you have to do that. So he'll lead you in the right prayer that'll invite Jesus into your heart. Secondly, what Joel's going to do, he's going to give you some free information, like now that you've done this, what am I supposed to do next, God? Tell me what I'm supposed to do. He'll give you a free little book, free information about getting back to church, what you ought to do. Thirdly, he's going to invite you to become part of our program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. That's where people, like some of the people that are right behind you right now, you can meet them before church service, have coffee, tea, nachos. They buy. That's good. They buy, you know, and they'll go over five spiritual principles. These five principles, when you get finished, will change your life. You'll find out about who you are in Christ Jesus, and I tell you, it's going to be wonderful. Get a spiritual personal trainer, because you need that. Is that all right? Only takes a few moments. People you came with will wait for you. Make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right over this way. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.